Good morning, everyone. My name is Rick Briscoe. I'm the legislative director of Open Carry, Texas, and today I'll be playing the part of C.J. Grisham. C.J. needed to hit the road on this night, so he asked me to fill in. I'd like to tell you just a little bit about our organization. We are a Second Amendment advocacy group. We're a grassroots group that we depend on participation of all of our members in helping spread our message around the state and to reach out to more people so that we can help to educate the public on what their rights actually are. And that's important because a lot of people think you have more rights under the Second Amendment and Article 1, Section 23 of our state constitution than you actually do. In fact, I'll quote one of our friends in the legislature, "Texas isn't as Texas as people think." I've had some very senior people in other organizations get annoyed when I said that, but it's the truth. And obviously, part of the purpose of educating people on what their rights are not is to urge them to contact their representatives in Austin, to urge them to support legislation to restore those rights to what we believe they should be. In this last legislative session, the 84th regular session, we participated in trying to get a number of bills through. The major bills involve the licensed open carry bill, and I'll give the simplest description you're going to hear from anybody of the substance of that bill. If you go online and look up House Bill 910, you're going to read through it, and everywhere the word concealed appears, it's stricken through. And that's important because open carry only applies to license holders, what used to be concealed handgun license holders. But now you have the option, the liberty, the freedom to choose whether to carry openly or whether to carry concealed. There are some circumstances where I choose to carry one way or the other, depending upon how I'm dressed, where I'm going. There's a sign out front. For example, if you're working in the yard in August and you're wearing shorts and a t-shirt, it's a little difficult to conceal things. Environmental factors are important. Interestingly, one of our northern neighbors, New Hampshire, has the reverse circumstance. They've had unlicensed open carry for many, many years. But it gets cold up there, and if you put a jacket on, it's a little bit difficult to openly carry. Now, if you've got a big Michelin Man puffy jacket, you need a size 4 extra huge belt to get it on. And so their legislature said, you know, we really haven't had any problems. Blood hasn't run in the streets. Maybe we ought to just let people conceal carry without a license, too. And the governor signed that bill. It's just a simple matter sometimes of not continuing to make dumb decisions. But back to Texas, there are a couple of additions to House Bill 910 that the governor signed that deal with signage and a couple of other matters such as that. But the real distinction is quite simply that if you're in a restaurant, as I was on January 1st in Austin, and you sit down to dinner, but you take your jacket off and your handgun is visible, you are not instantly a criminal. Quite literally. When I took my coat off and put it on the back of my chair the day before, I would have been a criminal for having done nothing that any of us would consider to be evil. Now, I'll tell you another story about the legislature. There are a lot of funny stories in the legislature. As you well know, in 1995, we got our concealed handgun license. And the opponents said blood would run in the streets. Well, it didn't. But one of the staff I was talking to said, you know, the real expression they used was blood would run eyeball deep in the streets on a tall horse. A little hyperbole, but humor never hurts. One of the other bills we worked on is the campus carry bill. You probably heard a great deal of debate about it. If you're watching the news from almost anywhere, you've heard about the recent sad events in Austin at UT, and that young lady lost her life in circumstances no one thought would be possible on such a protected place as a university campus. The sad fact of the matter is that an invisible line around the university campus is no protection at all. There was a University of Texas professor who testified at a Senate hearing this January, and she went on and on and on about how she feared that if guns were allowed in the classroom, one of her students was going to kill her. And she just wouldn't stop. Eventually, the chairwoman of the committee interrupted her and said, "Professor, if someone wants to kill you, that sign out front's not going to stop them." There is evil in the world. The ability to carry openly or concealed does not exempt you from bad things happening. Bad things happen to good people all the time. The difference is you may have an opportunity to defend yourself. One of the other bills that I must say I'm particularly proud of working to get passed was the knife preemption bill. I've been taking my pocket knife out frequently to illustrate that until September 1st of 2015, this knife was illegal in my home of San Antonio. Why? Because the blade for safety locked in place. San Antonio has a city ordinance, which I'm working on getting repealed, which made that an illegal knife. Now, that's bad enough, but the cities of Corpus Christi, Austin, and Dallas also had knife ordinances, all of which were inconsistent with each other and all of which were more restrictive than state law. We worked with a group called Knife Rights to get knives added to the preemption statute, which prevents the cities from enacting or enforcing such ordinances. That may seem like a small thing, but a pocket knife is an ordinary part of daily life in Texas. People carry it for opening boxes from UPS or FedEx, serious social encounters with oranges and apples, or a chicken fried steak that should have been sent through the tenderizer one more time. It's just part of daily life. I even asked some of the lady lobbyists in the Capitol, I did from the survey, "You carry a pocket knife, ma'am?" "Well, of course. It may be a little one, but yeah." And once again, the character of a tool, and that's what a knife or a gun is determined by the heart of the user. And as our district attorney in San Antonio has observed in public, what is it about bad guys? They don't obey the law. The law only really affects the law-abiding people, the very people you don't need the law for. We have many, many laws with which to punish people once the police catch them. But police, generally speaking, are not able to prevent crime. They're able to clean up afterwards and see that the court system has an opportunity to punish them. There were a couple of bills we worked on that we did not have success on that we worked on again. One of them was to expand the areas where you can carry. As you can see from the sign out front this morning, the 30-07 sign, we followed the pattern of many other states where businesses are inclined to put signage up almost immediately when the law changes, and then they figure out running customers off may not be the best business plan. For that reason, we have some no guns equals no money cards that have the qualifications of license holders on the backside as talking points, and we encourage our members, whenever they see a business they would ordinarily patronize, leave your hardware in the car, go in, ask to speak with the manager or owner, and very politely go over those talking points and then tell them that, by the way, the offense rate for license holders, all one really have a statewide, is 0.3%, which is actually less than for peace officers nationally. That's not to say that license holders are better than peace officers. It's to illustrate that both are law-abiding groups of people. And in particular, with reference to open carry, I've explained to some restaurant owners where alcohol is served that these are the very same people who've been concealed carrying in your restaurant for the last 20 years. And you've likely not had any particular problem with them. Now, one of the bills that we very sadly did not succeed on, but we came this close to succeeding on, was, once again with the knife rights group, removing knives altogether from the weapons list in Texas. As I said, my home is San Antonio, home of the Alamo, home of Jim Bowie, hero and defender of the Alamo. Our legislature chose to outlaw a Bowie knife by name without capitalizing it even, and failed to make any attempt whatsoever to define what constitutes a Bowie knife. We were able to get this bill out of the House on what's called the local and uncontested calendar, which means no one objected to it. And we had it in the Senate, and then there was an argument between a House Democrat committee chairman and a Senate Democrat committee chairman over an entirely unrelated bill that the governor had expressed concerns about one provision in that bill to a number of Republican members of that committee, and they happened to agree with the governor's position and voted against that one particular provision. It happened to be a bill that was authored by the Senate committee chairman. The net result was that they were at loggerheads and held each other's bills hostage. That is just a part of the political process sometimes, bad as it may be. And we thought we had it resolved, and literally at the last minute had the bill scheduled to go up on the floor of the Senate, and it got pulled down because the disagreement resumed. But we in Knife Rights will be back again to do that. Specifically, you may be aware that under state law, the maximum legal blade length that you can carry in a knife is 5 1/2 inches. Heaven forbid it should be 5 9/16 inches. There's simply no rational or logical explanation. It's an arbitrary number they just picked. And when you start talking about commercial products, the manufacturers, of course, have a difficult time dealing with inconsistent knife laws from one state to the next, because it's very difficult in a mass production era for a knife maker to make a knife that's legal in Texas or one that's legal in California, and you get the idea. For example, amongst knives, 6 inches is actually a common number amongst hunting knives and such, although there are exemptions while you're hunting that you can carry a larger blade. And you have to very carefully search to find one that fits the law. And I do urge you to be very careful in what your everyday carry knife might be, because if you run into a situation where for some reason you get stopped and frisked and you've got one that's not allowed to be carried every day, it won't be a good end. Among the objectives that we have for the next legislative session are we will continue to work on our so-called constitutional carry bill. The reason I say so-called is everyone seems to have a different idea of what that means. So let me tell you what we mean by it. We mean Vermont-style unlicensed carry, the right to carry either openly or concealed without license, without a state tax, so long as you can legally own that gun. Now, one of the problems is a number of our good police officers somehow have gotten the impression that constitutional carry means that felons can carry. No, it doesn't. Felons may not legally purchase, possess, whatever, a firearm, much less a handgun. Neither can people who've been convicted of a misdemeanor offense or domestic battery. People are subject to restraining orders. People have been declared drug addicts and so on. If you've purchased firearms, you're undoubtedly familiar with the form 1173, where the government asks you a whole string of questions. And if you answer one of them wrong, you can't buy it. And that's what we're talking about, is anyone who can legally buy that gun. At present time, there are 33 states which allow unlicensed open carry. You probably haven't heard about that very much for one very obvious reason. Nothing much happens. Now, in addition to the 33 that allow unlicensed open carry, Texas became the 45th state to allow open carry with license for unlicensed. We're among the last. There are at present 10 states which allow unlicensed, concealed and unlicensed open carry. our neighbors to the north, Oklahoma, are just about to pass a law allowing unlicensed open carry, which will make them the 34th state to allow that. And if you caught a message in all this, it's that Texas is behind the curve on almost all of us. And we urge each and every one of you to listen to the news, to go to our website, opencarrytexas.org, or our Facebook page, Open Carry Texas, and keep abreast of these issues, because when they come up in the legislature, we're going to urge everyone who believes in liberty, everyone who believes in their Second Amendment rights, their Article 1, Section 23 right, to pick up their telephone or go to their computer and send an email and give a little command guidance to their representative to vote for these bills. And that's important because the legislature, I'll ask you a question. What's the number one priority of a politician? You're exactly right, sir. And who does that? Constituents, people who actually vote. And most of the legislators, their staff, when they get a phone call or an email, they're going to check and see if you're in their district, if you're registered to vote, and whether you've actually voted. And if you have tagged all of those bases, they're going to pay a lot more attention to what you have to say than if someone in Dalhart calls a San Antonio representative and says, you know, I think this is a pretty good bill. And so please be aware of the practical reality of these things. The important part of that is also that not only are the legislators restricted by rule as to the number of bills they can introduce, but even if there wasn't such a rule, there are only so many things that one person can manage with them and their staff during a legislative session. And it's a short session. Everybody thinks it's a big, long session. It's not. If you don't hit the ground running on day two, you're already behind. The reason I say day two is I'll give them all a break. First day they get sworn in, have photos of the families, they're trying to get the phone hooked up and that kind of thing. But it really is a very arduous process. And our legislature and our constitution are designed to kill bills, not pass them. It takes a great deal of effort to push a bill through the legislature. There's a joke about the calendars committee in the House. It's where bills go to die. Several people have disagreed with me, but I'll stand by my position. The secrecy of the calendars committee is second only to the election of a pope. Finding out that they have a process where they assemble and a list of bills are presented, and any of the members of the committee can, quote, tag a bill. And when it gets tagged, that means they're opposed to it. So if there are, for example, three or four people who are opposed to a bill, number one can tag a bill on one meeting, number two can do it on a different meeting, number three, and then they'll all say, I didn't do that. But enough about some of the intrigue. The other area we intend to work on is also improving and clearing up some issues on our license carry bill. For example, at present, you must use either a belt or shoulder holster. If you're carrying it openly any other way, that's a problem. There was one arrest, I'll go ahead and mention it on the camera, we're aware of in Houston, involved a licensed carrier who unholstered his firearm and put it in the cup holder in his vehicle. Where it was in plain sight. It was no longer in a holster. And for some reason, a police officer observed it, and you can guess the following. Instead of delivering a lecture, as I would have hoped he had, he chose to exercise his discretion to arrest. It's that tech. If you carry, it's imperative that you know and follow the rules. What we hope to have done would be to simply remove the holster requirement altogether. And the reason behind that goes back to these 33 states that have unlicensed open carry. They've got no requirement whatsoever. just that you don't do anything bad with it or you'll be punished, and that you can legally own and possess it. And you're going, why haven't there been problems? Well, the 33 states, the practical answer is most of the people carry a holster almost all the time anyway, whether required to by law or not. It's just good common sense. But it won't make them a criminal if, for some reason, they don't use a holster on some occasion. Failing that, we are simply going to try to accomplish what the bill from now 3 years ago said, which was in a holster. It'll make it a lot less technical. In particular, we've gotten a great deal of feedback from the ladies that when they're in exercise clothing, a belt holster, shoulder holster, isn't really all that easily done, and that they're, believe it or not, there's a lot of commercial clothing which has grips and sundry pockets to carry with part of the gun exposed that they can buy off the shelf. So they're really a driving force behind that. As you may know, it costs $140 to apply for a license to carry a handgun. That fee was set in 1995. Technology has changed a great deal since then, and the background checks, fingerprints are now digitally scanned, and all that sort of affair is almost completely automated. There is the occasional situation where they need to go beyond a computer record and look at actual source documents, but that's very rare. And the long and short of it is we've got specific indications that $140 is way in excess of what it actually costs the state. We think it's either $25 or $40 to actually process it. And let's just take $40 and give them the benefit of the doubt. They're charging $100 too much, and we don't think our rights should be a profit center for the state. Now, how much money are we talking about? Well, total revenue from initial applications, renewals, change of addresses, special category people, various prosecutors, judges, and so on get their licenses for $25. There were a whole string of bills in the last session that give these special category people authorization, and then at the very bottom it would say an administrative fee of $25. After a while, I went, you know, maybe it only costs $25. We intend to press for that. We did last term, but we got pushback because the revenue is over $14 million a year, just under $35 million per budget cycle. And some people suggested that they simply wanted the money. To be charitable to them, the comptroller gives a budget forecast to the legislature in advance of the legislative session, and that's a number they have to deal with as a hard reality on what's available for the budget. And if you're not, let's just pick an arbitrary number, $15 or $20 million out of that budget. Okay, I'll concede the point. It gets difficult in the short term, but it needs to be done. Interestingly, a very close friend of mine is combat wounded Vietnam era Marine Scout Sniper, and he's got one good arm. And he rides around in a little electric wheelchair with a joystick to control it. And believe it or not, we met through our shooting club. And he's got an apparatus that lets him support a rifle and then shoot with one arm. He goes out there, has a great time, and so on. It never occurred to me that he didn't have a concealed handgun license. It just, right over the top of my head. His wife has one, I know. The point here is part of our qualification test right now is a 50-round course of fire. It's, quote, the demonstration of proficiency under the statute. And that was set by the Department of Public Safety. And you can say, well, that isn't necessary, whatever. It's what the law is. But for disabled persons such as himself, instead of being a demonstration of proficiency, it's an endurance test. Because he told me in just these words, I don't think I can complete that. But I surely would not want to be on the receiving end of anything he shot. In fact, another lobbyist, when I was discussing it with her, said, nobody's going to fire 50 rounds in self-defense. Well, yeah. And so one of the things that I intend to do this year is try to get DTS to create a shorter or modified course of demonstration proficiency for persons who, through disability or physical condition, for example, someone who's elderly, can demonstrate they can safely handle and operate a firearm without making any noise. It only seems fair. And I won't even bring up the American Disabilities Act. Yeah, right. There are a number of other things in our licensing law that were put in 1995, such as if a person is delinquent in their child support payments, if they're in arrears on their property taxes. Article 1, Section 23 ends with the words, with a view to prevent crime. Don't think it fits that description. And it's not that we are sympathetic to or encouraging people to be scofflaw parents, but if someone loses their job and they're in arrears on some child support payments until they can go to court and get them adjusted accordingly, we don't think they should lose their right to defend themselves. Just that simple. And we are, as you gathered from my remarks about knives, a Second Amendment group, not just a guns group. We get more publicity from the guns than anything else, but some of you have probably seen video of us on YouTube. We are at least one of the groups that walks around with some flags, passing out literature and talking to people, trying to both arouse the interest of people and to educate them about what we're trying to accomplish. We've started that way, and that's sort of like our first gear, and right now we're in the process of shifting gears to second gear. We're going to be using some additional tactics to recruit people to our movement who may not be interested in going out and participating in walks, either because of time, being hot, or they simply may have some misconception about problems that we've had with the police. Yeah, there have been a couple of incidents. Most of them have been peaceably resolved. And when I say peaceably, I mean by agreement. That we have talked with the chiefs of police in some of these departments and ironed out differences of opinion. And the way things go nowadays at some of these events, they may have an officer present who's there essentially as an observer, so if they get a 911 call, they've got eyeballs on the scene and can go, yeah, they sure are. They're walking around, they got flags, they're passing out literature, they're talking to people, they're not doing anything wrong. They're exercising their First and Second Amendment rights. And that is what we do stand for, First and Second Amendment rights. And with that, let me kind of pause or wrap up. I'd surely love to try to answer questions for two reasons. As I was explaining beforehand, not only do we like to answer your questions, but we like to hear what your concerns are. Because when we learn what people are concerned about, it better enables us to address them with members of the public at large. So with that, let me open it up to questions, please. Yeah, go ahead.
What would you say to an advocate of concealed carry that thinks open carry may be hurting gun rights by scaring the population and legislating against it?
We actually have had some people express that opinion. And let me begin by prefacing it with, we advocate the right to choose whether to be armed, and if so, how. Because we have amongst our members people who advocate concealed carry, they're all right with the idea of open carry, and some who really like open carry and are okay with concealed carry in some circumstances. And people like me who are in between. It depends on the particular circumstance I'm addressed, where I'm going, so on, as to how I carry. Now, about the people who say we're hurting the gun rights. Number one, they're already giving up the fight. We aren't. In the short term, we're dealing with people who choose to post who didn't before, because when licensed open carry was passed, we're facing very formidable opposition. The Bloomberg-funded crowd has gotten millions of dollars devoted to fighting this. We've got the Gun Sense crowd, whose executive director in Washington, D.C., is openly encouraging it. He even admitted it to Breitbart News, a very reputable news organization, that they were encouraging their members to file false police reports about anyone they see open carrying. We, on the other hand, are grassroots activists, and all we've got is our willingness and ability to stand up for what we think is right. Some of the people who have stood for the proposition you mentioned are finally coming around to the realization that these are anti-gunners, that no matter what advances we make, they are opposing them. If there's one gun left in America, they're going to say it's one too many. And so it really is a simple proposition of stand up, be counted, stand for something. And in the short term, yes, there may be pain. But the pattern in other states is signs start coming down. For example, I've spoken with the managers of any number of businesses or owners and tried to address their concern. One lady who's the managing partner of a restaurant said, well, we don't think guns and alcohol mix. Well, neither do we, ma'am. But the very same customers who are open carrying are the same people who've been concealed carrying in your restaurant for the last 20 years. Have you had any particular problem with them? No. And we went on at some length, but when she was finished, she said, well, I'll talk to the other partners and we'll see. So when I can get people to tell me what their concern is, I've got a lot better chance of convincing them that it's not a problem. But for example, Representative Diego Bernal, a fine gentleman, whose district is central downtown San Antonio, is quite legally going around and, quote, advising businesses of their right to post 30-06, 30-07 signs if they wish to exclude handguns. And if they wish, he provides at no cost to them the signage. That's perfectly legal activity. So please do not think that I am in any way impugning the man's integrity. We simply happen to use that as an illustration of people who, as a practical matter, are in opposition to what we are trying to accomplish in the implementation. Mr. Bernal, as is his privilege, voted against the bill in the House of Representatives last year. We're going to continue to work on representatives such as him and other businesses to convince them after the passage of some time that their concerns are unfounded. That once again, January 1st, blood did run in the streets in Austin when I was there. And a couple hundred of us assembled at the Capitol in celebration of the change of the law. We walked down Congress Avenue just having a fine day, even if it was a bit cold. And after we finished with that, we broke up and went to various restaurants and sat down, enjoyed a good meal, and other than being served very nicely by the wait staff, nothing remarkable happened. Some other questions, please.
Yeah. My wife and I, we don't carry, but we're looking into it this year, and our goal is this year to be licensed. So I just have a question about legality. You said that a gun must be holstered in order to carry. Does the holster have to be on a person, or could my wife carry a holster in her purse?
To be openly carried.
Well, I mean, to conceal.
Let me explain the distinction, please. Open carry means visible in whole or in part. Without a license, either one of you may legally carry in your automobile a handgun so long as it is not visible at all. In other words, it must be completely concealed. That's under the so-called Motorist Protection Act. That was first passed in, I believe, 2005. There have been two revisions of it since to clean up some messy details that occurred when a couple of police departments just didn't like it and tried to push back. It's now generally pretty well accepted that the police are going to leave you alone as a to travel under the voter's protection area. When you are talking about licensed carry, to openly carry that is visible in whole or part, it must be in a belt or shoulder holster. Now, it's not spelled out in House Bill 910, but under the penal code, the penalty provision talks about a handgun on or about the person. And that means within your reach without having to make a material change of your position. So let's use an automobile as an example. An individual gets in the driver's seat, removes the holster handgun. It remains in the holster. They sit it on the passenger seat where they can readily reach it, or in the cup holder, or even beside them on the seat. They can reach very easily without a material change of their position. However, if they put it on the back seat where it's visible, a number of attorneys I've spoken with have indicated their belief that that's not within the grasp of on or immediately about to the person, because you have to make a fairly major change of position to reach it. This is not settled by case law at this point. The only way you get case law is when someone gets prosecuted. Generally, the defendant's found guilty. There's an appeal, and an appellate court says, no, you can't do that. We hope it remains that way, simply because we don't want to see anyone be put through the process unnecessarily. The attorneys that I've spoken with, as I indicated, are uniformly of that opinion. But please understand, that's an attorney's opinion, and it's not a case law. My personal opinion, which is not legal advice, is that if you remove a holstered handgun and it remains in the holster where you can readily reach it on or about your person, you should be okay. Now, that doesn't mean that you can't run into some officer someplace who just doesn't like the idea and wants to put you through this process. There are 254 counties in Texas, and you've got a district attorney, a county attorney in each one of them, and I tried to count the number of law enforcement agencies in Texas to testify before the Senate. The lowest number I found was 1,700. The highest number I found was about 1,000 more than that. And let's just look at the obvious ones. You've got the county sheriff, you've got various city police, you've got various and sundry school district police, special district police. You know, if you've got a municipal utility district, they've got their own police. Bexar County has some quote unquote marshals. Let's see, what else? What have we got here in town? We've got constables. It just doesn't take long. And the point of that is each and every one of them could come up with a different interpretation, and each and every one of their officers. And the possibilities are nearly endless. I spoke with their own district attorney about it and mentioned those numbers and posed the question, what's the likelihood of each and every one of those departments reaching the same conclusion? He looked at me and said, it's not going to happen. It's just going to take time. These things will be resolved. You know, we're here in April. That's the fourth month since this new law went into effect. And interestingly, nothing much has happened. One of the training aspects that police, with our urging, went into is training their 911 operators and dispatchers to ask questions. If they get a call, I see a man with a gun. Well, the operator is supposed to ask, well, is it in a holster, man? Yeah, but he's got a gun. Is he arguing with anybody? Is he pointing at anyone? Well, he's walking down the street smoking a cigar, but he's got a gun on his head. Well, ma'am, there's a new law, and it's legal for a person with a license to do that. And I was asked in committee by one representative, well, I'm concerned about citizen feeling that they can't call 911. The answer is, of course, citizens should always call 911 if they have concerns. They should never be discouraged from doing so. And if in the process they're brought up to speed on the change in the law, and the operator says, go ahead, would you like just to send an officer out anyway? And she goes, yeah, maybe so. And they can go out and observe the situation and report back to dispatch that, yep, sure enough, it's a man walking down the street smoking a cigar with a gun on his head. The cigar bit because of a friend who smoked cigars, and I told that story to a friend who's a retired deputy sheriff, and actually asked it as a question about, you know, what you're supposed to do, and he frowned and looked at me and said, is there a smoking ordinance involved? Anyway, I'm supposed to wrap up. Is there another question I could answer real quickly? You got one, sir. Surely you've got a question. I couldn't have covered everything.
Well, a loaded rifle in the truck's okay.
Under state law, it is. San Antonio has an ordinance that's in the process of being repealed, which prohibited long guns being loaded in the city. It violates the state preemption statute and our state constitution. I've been working with the city attorney to actually get it off the books. I will say this. When I was in high school, lots of people carried rifles or shotguns in Iraq by the back end of their truck. As a practical matter these days, it's an invitation to get it stolen. But yes, it's legal.
Well, we do it all the time. It's tough not to when you leave the farm and run into town. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I was also wondering, are you aware that the Doubletree Hotel, the hotel for this conference, has 30-06 posted on the wall?
I was not specifically aware of that one. I know that several hotels do. They are supposed to be required to notify you of any postings at the time you make your reservation so that you have the opportunity to make other choices before you arrive to check in and see a sign on the door.
Right, yeah. I didn't bring my gun with me, but I was just wondering if the arrangers of the conference knew that, because as you said, it should affect their business.
The organizers of this conference specifically negotiated Friday and Saturday open carry permission as a part of the contract. The compromise was that the sign would go up Sunday because of another group coming in. I spoke with the manager yesterday, went over our talking points, asked him to please raise the matter with the manager. Very nice gentleman, said he sure he would. And it's just a matter of reaching out whenever we can. We sold over 25,000 of our No Guns Equals No Money cards between December and January, because every time the subject comes up, there's a guy, me, who keeps posting a link to these cards. And we depend upon the efforts of our members, and even if they're not members of our group, people who are sympathetic to the cause, to be a force multiplier for us. Well, let me thank you all very much for your time and hopefully your support in our initiatives come next year. Appreciate it.